that Westlands has. Why are we building new dams and spending billions of dollars of taxpayer money to provide more water when, quite frankly, we have a couple million acre feet just sitting there waiting to be used for other uses?
Tom Stokely, we'll have to end there. So, again, California Water Impact Network is c-win.org. Professor Russman, your law firm's website is landwater.org, is that right?
.com. But let me suggest that your listeners instead go to law.berkeley.edu. And get to the California Center on Environmental Law and Policy, CCELP. We're having a water law conference at Bolt Hall on Saturday, the 27th of January.
We'll have to leave it there, I'm afraid. But if people can go to the website of the UC Berkeley, again, it's law.berkeley.edu, you'll find more information about that. Thank you again, Professor Russman.
And you're listening to KPFA in Berkeley, KPFB in Berkeley, and KFCF in Fresno. The time is 1:31. Stay tuned next for Making Contact. Cherna says, the most powerful weapons in the so-called war on terror are not bombs or guns, but rather stories. Stories that conservative policymakers create and tell the American people about human nature. Have more from Professor Chernus in a
this week on Sunday Salon. As if Iran and Syria weren't enemies enough, what about China? Yes, there are people in the neoconservative establishment who think we should be preparing for military action against China. But China's a major trading partner for the United States and the rest of the world. On Sunday Salon, we'll look at China and the situation of Chinese manufacture and industry in our first hour. And in our second hour, labor and its role in opposing the United States occupation of Iraq. What is the Central Labor Council and what are pacifists thinking of doing to influence the Bush administration? That's this Sunday, 9 to 11 a.m., 94.1 FM, Sunday Salon with me, Larry Bensky.
This week on Making Contact.
Today, our subject is the current president and his two wars, his war on terrorism and his war on sin, which I see as, in fact, two sides of the same war.
That's author Ira Chernus, a religious studies professor at the University of Colorado at Boulder. On this edition, Professor Chernus examines the connections between conservative religious doctrine, moral values, and the Bush administration's national security policies, and what's driving U.S. policy, according to Chernus, may not be what you think. I'm Tina Rubio, and this is Making Contact, a program connecting people, vital ideas, and important information. Chernus says, the most powerful weapons in the so-called war on terror are not bombs or guns, but rather stories. Stories that conservative policymakers create and tell the American people about human nature and a world divided between absolute good and absolute evil. The following are excerpts from a speech by Ira Chernus given at the University of Chicago. It was part of the university's World Beyond the Headlines lecture series.
I just happened to come across these words from William Arkin, a very insightful analyst of U.S. national security policy. This is what Arkin says. Quote, terrorists cannot destroy America. Every time we pretend we are fighting for our survival, we not only confer greater power and importance to terrorists than they deserve, but we also at the same time act as their main recruiting agent by suggesting that they have the slightest potential for success. Now, Arkin's surely right about that. No attacks upon American soil can literally destroy America. So why is our public discourse so filled with such apocalyptic talk about the threat to the very existence of our nation? Well, President Bush suggested one good reason when he said, quote, "Today we face an enemy every bit as determined to destroy us as the Axis powers in World War II or the Soviet Union during the Cold War." Indeed, ever since September 2001, Mr. Bush has insisted that the war on terrorism is analogous to, or perhaps even a continuation of, World War II and the Cold War. Those earlier wars taught Americans to view their enemies not merely as opposing nations struggling to change the global balance of power, but as demonic forces who, if allowed, would end the very existence of the United States. In the face of such apocalyptic fears, it seemed only natural that the nation's resources should be mobilized to stave off the threat, that national security should be our highest priority. Those assumptions have become so widespread and so deeply embedded in our national discourse that they generally pass without question. In fact, the whole enterprise of the national security state makes no sense unless you begin with a premise that we are profoundly insecure. So it seems to me more accurate to say that, at least since World War II, we've lived in a national insecurity state. So let's start with the president himself. Karl Rove claims that when Bush first decided to run for governor of Texas back in 1993, Bush told Rove, quote, "The principal reason I want to seek office is to bring about a cultural change from a culture of the 1960s, which said, if it feels good, do it, to a culture of personal responsibility," end of quote. Now, there's a big story packed into that little sentence. It tells of a battle between two ways of life, one dedicated to instant gratification of every desire, the other devoted to rigid self-control. It tells of a culture gone astray because it chose feeling good over being responsible. And it tells of a hero who appears on the scene to transform the culture by setting it on the path of good behavior. And this is the story that's always been at the center of Bush's political career. He's deftly intertwined it with a story about an evangelical Christian faith. And the story should be quite familiar in its basic structure to anyone who knows much about Christian thought. The story says we're all sinners. We're all prone to behave in ways that offend God. Nevertheless, God will accept us if we accept the grace that God gives us through his only begotten Son. But that doesn't make us any less sinful or any more deserving of grace. In fact, in this theology, being convinced that we are sinners, as Bush often says, sinners who don't deserve to be saved, being convinced of that is the prerequisite for and the surest sign of being saved. This is the paradoxical logic underlying Bush's faith story.
But President Bush is not alone. Millions of Americans believe in this framework. Turner says believers gain a sense of security when they know their place on the battleground between good and evil.
And indeed, it's the temptation to sin that gives them a chance to prove how strong their faith is. So in a sense, they need the devil so that they can prove their power to withstand him. So their chosen route to certainty and security requires them to be forever fighting a spiritual enemy, since they must confess that they are sinners. They must be forever uncertain and insecure about whether they will win the final victory over the devil. And since it's the eternal fate of their soul that's at stake, their insecurity might well rise to the level of terror. Which brings us to the war on terror. The crux of my argument is that on September 11th, 2001, George W. Bush took this story about a war of virtue against sin, God against the devil, and he applied it on a global scale to a war against terrorists. Now, there was nothing inevitable about choosing that story to interpret the tragedy of 9/11. There were any number of stories that were available. And when the World Trade Center was first bombed in 1993, the Clinton administration responded with a very different story, a story about crime and criminals who had to be brought to justice, but not a story about war. But on 9/11, Bush and his advisors, most of whom were neoconservatives, immediately began to tell a war story. They had honed these stories very finely before 9/11. Now let's talk for a minute about the neoconservative approach to the world. That movement began back in the 1960s in much the same way that Bush says his political career began. It was a domestic crusade by the neocons to undo the evil that they saw in the cultural changes of the 1960s, changes that they still believe threatened to destroy the fabric of American society. In one sense, the neocons' guiding story is the inverse of Bush's Christian story. For the Christians, moral strength is an important sign of and a means to true faith. For the neocons, it's the other way around. Strength is the central value, and religious faith and moral virtue are ways, but not the only ways, to achieve moral strength. But nevertheless, Bush could feel quite at home with the neocons because his faith story agrees in so many ways with the neocons' story. They both believe in original sin and the danger that it poses to society. The first great neocon writer, Irving Kristol, once wrote that, quote, "The human condition placed inherent limitations on human possibility. Original sin was one way of saying this, and I had no problem with that doctrine." Kristol and so many of the neocons are Jewish, but they adopt a version of the theory of original sin, as Bush's own story rests on as well. And Bush and the neocons agree on several other key points. They agree that life is an endless series of contests, that there's a fear of too much freedom, a need for self-scrutiny and self-control, crucial role of traditional moral values in holding society together, and the desire for certainty and the fear of uncertainty. So when 9/11 came, both Bush and the neocons had a fundamental set of premises built into the story that they were ready to apply to that attack. They agreed that the issue was absolute good against absolute evil. They agreed that Americans should not view the attackers as human beings with humanly understandable grievances, but rather the attackers must be portrayed as monsters to be destroyed. The monster's actions, both past and future, must be presented as a threat to the nation's very existence. Well, that's the way the president and the neocons have depicted the attackers ever since 9/11. Their stories of the war on terror generate and perpetuate the very insecurity that they claim to stand against. They can never escape the enemy threat because they must always be demonstrating their will and their resolve to confront that threat. If there were no evildoers to fight against, how could they prove their virtue and their strength in the fight against sin?
We'll have more from Professor Chernus in a few moments. You're listening to Making Contact, a production of the National Radio Project. If you'd like more information or for CD copies of this program, please call 800-529-5736. That's 800-529-5736. You can also download programs or get our podcasts at radioproject.org. The storyline positing the U.S. as a force of good, confronting multiple foreign forces of evil, continues to be a very popular and publicly successful theme. But Professor Chernus says this stance is actually making Americans feel less secure about the safety of the world around them, including fears of another attack like 9/11. But why do so many buy into this framework? Again, here's author and professor Ira Chernus.
Well, I'm going to suggest two different kinds of answers. I'm sure there are many answers, but two in particular I've focused on. First, the story that the Bush administration tells since 9/11 fits perfectly with the apocalyptic worldview that the nation had adopted during the Cold War years and even earlier, back into World War II, even before then. The war on terrorism particularly has revived the Cold War mindset, which made us all citizens of a national insecurity state. After so many decades, it seems natural to most Americans to assume that we face a threat to our nation's very existence from a network of monsters bent on destroying us utterly, even if there's no empirical evidence to support that fear. Then I see a second reason for the popular appeal of the Bush administration's story of the war on terrorism. And the conservative Christians' war against sin epitomizes this in particularly stark form, but I'm going to suggest it's a more widespread pattern in our culture. So let's go back first to look at conservative Christians, but remember, my point is going to be that what we see particularly clearly in the conservative Christian movement is something that's actually more widespread throughout the culture. Here's Randall Balmer, a leading scholar of evangelical religion, explaining why evangelical Christians have such a strong sense of the battle between good and evil. He says people need boundaries in their lives, a sense of limits, a feeling for what's appropriate and inappropriate, right and wrong, true and heretical. Evangelicalism provides that. For a growing number of Americans, it offers an unambiguous morality in an age of moral and ethical uncertainty, a place of retreat and escape. End of quote. In fact, though, I think evangelicals don't really find a place of escape. Now listen to Richard Land. He's a friend of George W. Bush and a top official in the Southern Baptist Convention. And he recalled the conversation with his wife right after Bill Clinton was elected president in 93. Is a long quote. He says, "My wife and I, we're the same age as the Clintons, same age as the Bushes." She said, "The people that were sitting around in Volkswagen vans, smoking pot with peace symbols on their vans, hanging around their necks, they're running the country now, aren't they?" And I said, "Yes, they are." Basically, this is still Land, it breaks down to this enormous fault line. On one side of this fault line, you have people who have a traditional view of morality. Some things are always right, some things are always wrong. And if you accept a society in which that's not true, then anything becomes possible. On the other side of this fault line, you have what I would call a postmodern worldview. We get to decide for ourselves what's right and what's wrong, what's true and what's not true, to the extent that there is truth. That's the end of the quote from Land. So Land's point is clear enough. If we can decide for ourselves what is true, then he says anything becomes possible. And that's the nub of the problem for conservative Christians. They want to avoid, at all costs, a world where anything is possible. Their personal theology and their rigidly traditional values are ways to convince themselves that it's simply not true that anything is possible. Yet they see themselves surrounded by people who seem to live as if anything is possible. On the one hand, they say, are people who believe that moral values are universal, timeless truths, and once we have those fixed truths, we should stick with them no matter what. On the other hand, these conservatives say, there are the sinners, the secular humanists. They believe that moral values change with the times, that we should each be free to discover or invent values for ourselves based on our individual thoughts and experiences. So in the conservative evangelicals' dualistic view of society, the sinners who reject timeless moral truth are the root of all the world's problems. Now, many sociologists who study this so-called culture war say that this picture is vastly exaggerated. When they go out and do studies, they find most Americans have much more complex, nuanced social views, and they can't be placed neatly either into one box or the other. But conservatives find it comforting to see the world through their simplified, dualistic lens. But in order to get that comfort, they have to believe that they are a beleaguered minority, defending God's virtue against a vast and growing mob of sinners who just want to do their own thing. The conservatives have to see the possibility of sin all around them on the outside, just as they see the possibility of giving in to their own sinful impulses on the inside. But it's too easy and misleading to blame conservative Christians for the war on terror. If they were the only ones supporting the war, it would have collapsed long ago, because the story the administration uses to justify it would have lost its legitimacy. And since the story still seems to be so widely accepted, I think it reflects a desire that goes far beyond the conservative Christian community. That is, the conservative Christians epitomize just in particularly clear form a much more widespread longing throughout this country for a clear-cut line dividing good from evil, a line that assures people that there still are indeed absolute moral principles that can never be changed and should never be questioned. The desire to have this foundation of fixed values may be more important on the conservative side than to liberals and centrists, but it cuts across the political spectrum and it influences the lives of many, perhaps most Americans. So I think the president articulates the deepest appeal of the war on terrorism when he says things like, quote, "We have seen that evil is real. It is enough to know that evil, like goodness, exists." When Rudolph Giuliani addressed the United Nations just a few weeks after 9/11, he demanded that, quote, "The era of moral relativism must end. Moral relativism does not have a place in this discussion and debate." And I think that there were millions of Americans who responded positively to his words. And they weren't all just conservatives. So here's the crux of the problem. Since 9/11, our public discourse has fused together two quite distinct questions. On the one hand, there's the question, how should we seek and find moral truth? Should we look to some external, eternally valid authority? Or should we each find our own individual path to the truth? That's a question that has been vexing and will continue to vex American society for a long time. But we cannot deal effectively with that question as long as we fuse and confuse it with another very separate question: how can we keep our nation as safe as possible? As long as the archetypal terrorist serves as our dominant symbol of evil and sin and the devil, we'll not be able to keep those two kinds of questions separate. The war on terrorism locks us more firmly into this basic confusion in our national life. And this confusion has a special impact on political liberals, because with the best of intentions, many liberals support the idea of a war against terrorism abroad as a tragic necessity, while they try to resist the Bush administration's conservative moralism here at home. So they end up unwittingly supporting and legitimating the conservatives' battle against sinners at home as well as abroad. By embracing Bush's story of the war on terrorism, they're drawn into the orbit of his moral quest. The war and the domestic efforts of Bush and the neocons are inseparable parts of the same storyline, a package deal. If you buy one part of the deal, you buy the whole thing. And the whole thing always leads back to the same self-defeating pattern. The national insecurity state undermines the security it claims to provide, because it fights against an enemy that it assumes and ensures will always be there. The national insecurity state may speak of its hope for a secure, peaceful future, but there's no way to talk about security without voicing fears of insecurity. There's no way to express optimism without expressing despair. Hope for peace and security, like the whole structure of the national insecurity state, makes sense only if the state sees itself beset on every side by enemies. And even if we define national security in the Bush administration's own terms, the war on terrorism has undermined our security. You know, the war was supposed to build the new American century, a unipolar world in which the U.S. would be the sole remaining superpower. But every day, it looks more and more like the 21st century will be the multipolar century, with any number of powerful nations and regional groupings successfully challenging U.S. economic, diplomatic, and military preeminence. The administration's unilateralism and militarism has accelerated the decline of U.S. power and influence around the world. Since the war on terror depends on the fears stirred up by the administration's apocalyptic stories, it is those stories themselves that make us less secure, less powerful, less influential, and less able to achieve the administration's goals in foreign affairs.
So we're caught in a vicious cycle, and Cherna says the Bush administration's aggressive policies actually weaken the U.S.'s power to control global events.
And when other nations act independent of U.S. interests, they're depicted as imminent dangers to our national security. And the only response that's allowed in the prevailing story is to ratchet up our strength and fight back. So the story frightens the public into supporting the same aggressive policies that weaken and frighten us even more. We seem to be stuck in this circle. Right now, there's no end in sight. But we don't have to stay stuck. Already, there's growing awareness that the war on terror is doing more harm than good. Even from a few voices in the mainstream media, we hear this. William Arkin, who I quoted early, recently wrote that the war against terrorism is the problem at this point. Well-known writers like James Fallows, who was here just recently, George Soros, David Sanger of the New York Times, all suggesting that it's time to end the war on terrorism. And so perhaps as the losses to American power, American prestige, and American life mount, Americans may eventually see that a simplistic moralism and this pervasive fear of apocalyptic disaster actually weaken our society here at home. And they make every step toward positive change look like a looming danger. And that plays right into the hands of the conservatives who are dedicated to preventing the change that we need so badly. But that still leaves us with a question that nags consciously or unconsciously at huge numbers of Americans. How can we have some kind of shared foundation of absolute moral values undergirding our national life? Is there a new way to think about security that could give us that satisfying sense of moral certainty, yet allow for freedom in choosing our values and make the U.S. more secure, all without any need for finding monsters to destroy? This new approach would have to allow for a commitment to objective, eternal transhuman values, yet offer each individual the freedom to search for their own moral values. It would have to act out a moral drama of good against evil, yet not set America against any enemies. It would have to be based on hope rather than on terror, viewing systemic structural change as progress rather than as threat. And finally, it would have to be rooted in distinctively American traditions to unify the public and satisfy the patriotic urge. Now, to imagine a basis for American policy that would do all that is a very tall order. But it turns out that Americans have been doing that, doing all those things at the same time for a long time. Those of us on the political left don't have to agonize about how to appeal on the basis of moral principle while still promoting a progressive vision and program, because Americans have always managed to combine the two, and usually rather effortlessly, and they still do. We can look back to the abolitionists, the nonviolence movement born in World War I, the civil rights movement, the campaign to end the Vietnam War. All of them had a very strong basis in faith in eternal moral principles. And today, there's a resurgence of progressive faith-based activism and community organizing, not the Bush administration's faith-based initiatives, but truly progressive and socially forward-looking faith-based activism. Many of these people respond to what they hear as a moral call from on high or from some eternal principle deep within, but they don't respond with terror. They don't go searching out monsters to destroy. They open their minds and hearts to all people of goodwill who will work together with them to build a better society. And I think if we want a storyteller who will offer us an alternative, a positive progressive alternative based on eternal moral principles, an alternative to the story of the Bush administration and the neocons, certainly our greatest storyteller was the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. And whatever he taught was always based on his belief in an eternal, universal moral grounding, which I guess he expressed most famously when he said, "We're caught in an inescapable network of mutuality tied in a single garment of destiny." And this was the key to his embrace of nonviolence. He preached that no one can be an enemy to anyone else because no one is ever really separate from anyone else. We're all tied together. All nations are already tied together. The United States is tied to Iran and North Korea and Venezuela. And George W. Bush is tied to Osama bin Laden and Kim Jong-il and Hugo Chavez in world affairs.